next couple of lectures, we are going to discuss some characterization techniques. So characterization basically means we want to understand what is the microstructure of the material and accordingly what are the properties of the material. Sometimes we will measure a certain property to understand the microstructure. Sometimes we will just see the microstructure, let's say in under an electron microscope, and then accordingly we will try to understand the properties. Often we'll do both. Okay. So characterization techniques basically are the set of these all of these techniques that can be used for understanding a certain material. In the case of carbon, it becomes very, very important to characterize the material not just at its final stage, but also during the fabrication process. Because you know that all our carbon materials, they strongly depend, at least the graphitic carbon materials, so they all are very strongly dependent on the heat treatment temperature at which they were prepared. Sometimes we need to, if we want to understand the carbonization mechanism, pyrolysis mechanism, or graphitization mechanism, in all cases, what we need to do is we need to characterize the material at different process temperatures. So if, let's say, I take a new polymer, I have no idea about it, and then I want to understand what kind of carbon I'm going to get from it. Okay, I can have some things I can guess, but let's say I don't know anything about the chemical structure of that polymer. Then what I can do is I can place it inside my furnace, heat it, let's say up to 900 degrees, and then I take some type of, I do certain analysis that tells me this is the size of the or fraction of the crystallites inside this material. Okay, then I further heat treat it at 1000 degrees, 1100, 1200, and so on. Same sample or different samples. The idea is that I can then plot all of these points and I can see what is the effect of increase in process temperature on the crystallinity of the material, because crystallinity can be important for various reasons, because that will give me increased electrical conductivity, also the Young's modulus will increase, and so on. So this is important for all carbon materials. So what are the common techniques that are used for understanding carbon materials? Well, the first one that we are going to talk about today, is X-ray diffraction. So X-ray diffraction technique is probably the most commonly used technique as on date, and also in the past it has been used. In fact, this technique is what helped us understand different types of carbon materials. Even the discovery of non-graphitizing carbons, for example, or at least when we understood what are non-graphitizing carbons. The study by Rosalind Franklin was also based on X-ray diffraction. There were also a lot of very fundamental studies about activated carbons, even before what Rosalind Franklin did. Even those studies were based on X-ray diffraction patterning. So this is something which is very common, which is very important for anybody who is working in the field of carbon. By the end of this lecture, so I will probably not go too much into the details of the fundamentals of X-ray diffraction. I will focus more on how this technique is used for carbon materials and how do you analyze the X-ray diffraction patterns for a graphitic carbon material. So towards the end of this lecture, you should be able to at least figure out that, what are the primary peaks for graphite and graphite-like carbons, and more importantly, you should be able to understand how does the shape of these peaks change when we have more disorder or more order in our carbon material. Okay, so let's get started. So we are not going to talk too much about the fundamental things, but I will very, very briefly on this slide, I will let you know. X-rays, you know that they what is their wavelength range? They are basically of the same order of the interatomic distances. So when you want to understand, when you want to get the atomic resolution, what do you need? You need to also have your characterization tool should also be of that range, of that order. Why? Because, well, if the lambda or the wavelength of your whatever radiation is too much larger than the interatomic distance, I have mentioned it as A here, okay? If it is too much larger, then it will reflect, okay? If it is too small, much smaller than your interatomic distance, let's say you have two atoms, your wavelength is so small that it will just pass through your, it will just go through between two atoms. So there will be, that is what we call as transmission. These principles are also used in different types of, spectroscopic or microscopic techniques. But in this particular case, what we want is diffraction. Diffraction takes place when your lambda is pretty much of the same order of the interatomic distance. Okay, so what is diffraction, by the way? When there is an incident ray, and then there is, let's say, a particle which can change the direction of that particular ray or wave. So this is, we are now essentially talking about the wave-like nature of the whatever electromagnetic radiation that you're using. Okay, so that wave is bent and redirected into in a certain direction. That is what we call as diffraction. Very similar phenomena, very much related phenomenon is also scattering, but there is a minor difference. In fact, you will often also hear the word, the term scattering in the context of X-ray diffraction. There's a minor difference though, that scattering can take place in all directions, while diffraction is rather takes place in specific directions. What is important in the case of diffraction, or for us to get the diffraction patterns, is that there is a constructive interference between the waves. Okay, what is constructive, what is a destructive interference, that you can learn. As I said, I will also mention some references, and also towards the end some other NPTEL lectures, from there you can learn. But this is something probably you also remember from these slit experiments, constructive and destructive interference patterns. So we need to have the constructive interference in order to have the diffraction patterns. And what is most important when it comes to X-ray diffraction, the entire studies, entire field is kind of based on what is known as the Bragg's law. So also Bragg's law, it's very simple, 2d sine theta equals n lambda. And these are the, so what is d? D is the most important parameter for us. That is what is your interplanar distance. Interplanar means the planes of the crystal, 1, 2, 3. So what is the distance between them? That is what is d. Okay. Now, when we talk about graphite, we have a hexagonal system. Hexagonal crystal, and it's not hexagonal closed packed system. That is something you need to remember, because this Bragg's law has certain different parameters when we talk about, let's say, a cubic system. Cubic and hexagonal already have slightly different parameters. In the case of graphite like carbons, what is also very interesting is that we don't have crystallites, like in the case of cubic systems, you will have certain crystalline regions and certain amorphous regions, let's say. Or there will be certain cubic systems which at a certain temperature, they convert from FCC to BCC, for example. In those cases, X-ray diffraction becomes very important. You try to understand. But you can very clearly see the change in the parameters of FCC and BCC using X-ray diffraction. In the case of carbon, what we have is we have arrangement of layers, but those layers have a lot of defects and they are probably turbostratically arranged. And what we want to get with the increase in temperature, we want to have most of the defects annealed out. We want to get more and more order. So the ordering does take place, but it's very gradual. So it does not so happen that at a given temperature point, let's say 1200 degrees centigrade, it will never happen that at 1200 you suddenly see a jump in the properties, or completely changed crystal structure. You will not see big difference in your despacing. Also, this is gradual, and that is why it becomes a little bit tricky to understand how does this increase take place. And also it becomes a little bit tricky to define the crystal structure, because we know the crystal structure for graphite is well defined, but most of the carbons that we are dealing with, they are not graphite. They do not have a 3D arrangement. So for us to define the crystal parameters for them is also tricky, also given they contain a lot of defects and so on, and we don't understand the nature of these defects as well. This is what we are going to discuss, and we will also talk about how we can come to a certain trade-off, a certain set of parameters which gives us more or less accurate information. Okay, so this is the Bragg's law. What are the other terms used? Theta. Theta is your Bragg's angle. Basically, this is the angle of your incident ray. And from a very simple geometry, you can understand how does a ray is incident and how does it get diffracted, and what is the relationship between theta and 2 theta. So this is what I will quickly explain to you.
Okay, so now let us quickly derive the Bragg's law. So here I have drawn two planes of your crystal with the atoms, and this is your first incident X-ray, and this is your diffracted X-ray. You can also use the term reflection. Okay, here is the second one, and that is also diffracted. Okay, now these angles here, this is the angle of your incident ray, so that is theta, let's say, and this will also be equal to theta, right? And now what we need to do is we need to find out the relationship of D. This is your spacing between the two layers, okay? This is what you need to find out. And for this purpose, what we will need is a few more, we need some triangles to find out certain relationships between the angles. So let me draw one perpendicular on this line and on both of these lines, okay? So when I say perpendicular, this means that this angle is 90, this angle is also 90, and this value here is my D, okay? Now, if you will see from these two triangles, you can very easily calculate that this angle and this angle are also equal to theta, okay? What we need to do is we need to find out the relationship of D with lambda, with that of the wavelength. Okay, you know that the Bragg's law is valid only when there is constructive interference. And for the constructive interference, there is a condition that lambda should have its integer multiples, which means we should have something like n lambda, only then there will be a constructive interference. And what we need to find out, something in terms of d and theta. So this is now very simple. From these triangles, you can see that this value is equal to d sine theta. And similarly, this value here. And why do we care about these two values? Because, well, till here, both our beams, the first one and the second one, they both traveled equal distance, right? And also, after this particular value here, this part and this part are also equal. The only additional part is this 2 times d sine theta that your second X-ray has traveled. So that is basically it, 2 times d sine theta. And this itself is your Bragg's law. It is as simple as that.
Okay, so another thing that is important for us here is what is the experimental value? What is the value that you receive from your experiments? That is a value of d. Okay, because d is the unknown in the Bragg's equation for us, in the Bragg's law. Okay, we know the theta. Theta is the value of the angle. So we know always the incident angle, and we also have a detector in our instrument. So we know the value of 2 theta. That is what basically you will get. Okay, so you can calculate the theta. We always know the value of lambda because that is the wavelength that we used. So in most cases, in the most commonly used wavelength is copper K alpha. And on top, I have already mentioned the value of it. It is 1.5406 angstrom. Okay, so this value you will always know. So the only thing that is unknown is your d. Okay, now n is the order of your, so if you get, for example, I say 00 L planes, you know what is, if you, by the way, do see the graphite crystal structure lecture as well. So what are 00 L planes? 002, half of it 004, 006. Okay, so you have, I just call them 00L, but 2, 4, 6, these are the reflections or the next order of your, of the same type of planes. So what value you will, so you will get a certain peak for 002 plane, and then after some time you might get a peak which is shorter than this one, that is known as the reflection, and that is also known as the second order peak for 00L plane. So in that case, the value of N is 2. In the case of 006, it will be 3. 002, it will be 1. So in most cases, we are going to just use a value of N as 1. Okay. So here I have also mentioned that D is related to HKL and to A, that is your crystal lattice parameter as well. Okay. So HKL, what are HKL? These are Miller indices of any plane. Okay. So here I've mentioned these two relationships. One is for cubic crystal and the other one is for hexagonal crystal systems. Often what happens is when you get the value of D from your experiment, then you can, using these relationships, you can find out what are the possible values of HKL. often you will, because all three of them are unknown, you will probably often, you know, you will know some things about your material. So you will also guess, like, okay, it can be 100 or it can be 111 and 002, whatever. So you will guess certain values and you will find out if their summation, if what the values that you've received that satisfy this kind of equation. And then whatever different values from different peaks you get from a certain X-ray diffraction pattern, you will get different peaks, right, in one pattern itself, one diffractogram itself. So in that case, you will get some sets of values for your HKL, and often there are some rules which will say, okay, the summation of HKL is even, in that case it could be FCC or it could be BCC, or if the summation is odd, and then in that case this is the possible crystal structure. So basically, based on those rules, then you will guess what is your material. Similarly, for hexagonal systems, the only difference is that you now also have a value of C. These are the exercises you will do if your crystal structure is completely unknown to you. If you have no idea, let's say, even whether the material is FCC, BCC, you have no idea about it. Maybe you even don't know what kind of metal it is. In that case, you will start from these, you know, from here, that you now guess your HKL values and whether it is closer to FCC or closer to BCC or closer to a simple cubic system. Accordingly, you will guess what is your material. But in the case of carbon materials, especially graphitic carbon materials, we already know what we are dealing with. We know the crystal structure of graphite. We know that we have basal planes. Basal planes are most important. So if we have, when we have these graphene-like sheets stacked on top of each other, these planes are known as the basal planes, and these are denoted as 00L. Why 00L? Because, well, the first one is 002. If you remember the unit cell of graphite, we have ABA, so 1A, then a B, and then an A layer again. And this entire thing is your crystal parameter C. So C basically also has one sandwiched B-type layer. Okay, so when you calculate the lattice parameters, again we have done it in the graphite crystal structure class, then you will find out that these are 002 planes, and these are kind of the most important planes because this is what actually defines all the properties. This plane and the organization of this plane is what defines most of the properties. Okay, so the point is that we don't really need to go into these kind of you know, exercises where we need to guess the crystal parameters, but what we rather need to do is to see whether or not, what is the location and the width of the peak for 002 and some other peaks. Okay, so yeah, these are still, I'm talking about the basics of X-ray diffraction. So diffractogram is the kind of, you know, that pattern where you get all your peaks, that is known as diffractogram. Also, people call it X-ray diffraction pattern. It is not called spectrum, by the way. So spectrum is something, although it looks very similar. And certain things are also valid for both spectra and diffractograms. So they're similar in some sense, but there are minor differences. So one important difference is that in the case of spectra, we are often measuring a property which is related to energy. But in the case of diffractograms, what we are measuring is just more of a geometric calculation. So that is one important thing. Another thing is that in the case of spectra, you will often have, if you have a spectrum of a mixture, then it is additive. So properties of A plus properties of B will give you the properties of A plus B. But that is not the case. That is not necessarily the case in the, you know, when it comes to diffraction patterns. So that is why they are slightly different. So it's not correct to call this X-ray spectrum or anything. That's why we use the term diffractograms. Okay. So here I have shown a very basic schematic of, you know, of an instrument. So you see that we have a cathode ray tube. Cathode ray tube is used for the production of X-rays. You can also have any other method. You can go to a synchrotron also, and then you can have, you know, any source of X-rays, as long as you have well-defined lambda. And in some very specialized cases, you might also use a mixture of lambda. There the you know, there the calculations are slightly different. We will not go into that. So for common X-ray diffraction analyses that are performed for chemical compounds or materials, In that case, we have often a cathode ray tube, and that is where you'll then you'll have certain wavelength filters, and then you have your sample at a certain angle, and the X-rays are then incident upon the sample, and then they are diffracted, and you can see the angles are theta and 2 theta. Okay, and then of course, yes, you have a detector, and it is typically the detector that rotates and not the cathode ray tube, although in some cases, some instruments may also have the tube or the source of X-rays rotating, but in most of the common X-ray diffraction equipment, you have the detector that is rotating with a certain angular speed. Okay. So now let us come to the XRD analysis of carbon materials. So we'll start with graphite, because first of all, you need to understand what is graphite. Only then we will understand the materials that are not graphite or that we are comparing with graphite. So you remember this this little schematic, huh? LA and LC. What is LA? It's the crystallite diameter. And this is if you're looking from the, you know, the top view, and the stack thickness is when you have a lot of these sheets stacked on top of each other. Then how many sheets are stacked? That is stack thickness. Okay. What would be the D, interlayer spacing? That is between the spacing between two layers. So within LC, if you, let's say your LC equals 5 times D. Okay, so if you have 5 layers, so whatever is the spacing, or 6 layers, so whatever is the spacing between them, that is the spacing which is known as D, which is your most important crystal parameter, especially in the XRD studies. Okay, yeah, so that is one thing that I've already mentioned. But the other thing is that what is the width? Now, we know that we will get a certain peak if we have a graphite-like material. If you have pure graphite, you will get a sharp peak for 002 planes. If you don't have a pure graphite, then you will get a broader peak. But now, how is this width of the peak related to your graphite or graphite-like materials? This is very important to us. Okay, how do you measure the peak width? So let's say this is any standard given peak in your XRD pattern, and you have the peak is not too sharp at the end, it broadens a little bit. So there are two important parameters here. When you measure the width of your peak, you often measure it at the center or at half of its height. And that measurement is known as full width at half maximum. So that is what you call as your peak width. And the position of the peak is essentially your Bragg angle, 2 theta. Okay. So now there is also another important equation that is used for the calculation of the parameters, that is where you will get your LC and LA values. So this equation is known as Schwerer equation. So this is your Schwerer equation, which basically relates the average crystallite size B to the rest of the crystal parameters, the lambda and cos theta value. Theta here still is the same. So you will get this from your the diffraction patterns, right? You can get the value of 2 theta and you can calculate theta. Okay. What else we have? The other new things that we have here. Beta is basically nothing but your FWHM. So that is your in radians, you take your peak width. Okay. So this is also something that you can experimentally obtain. What else is there? There's something known as a shape factor. So you see, it is like a constant in this equation. That is not something that you will get experimentally. That K is important. And typically, for most materials, the value of K is taken between 0.9 and 1.2. In actually many calculations, it is just taken as 1. But in the case of different carbons, then you will this value of K will differ. But the idea of Schwerer equation is that this is the equation that will give you the value of both LA and LC from different peaks, because from different set of plates. Okay, fine. So now let us come to what is the value of K for graphitic for carbon materials. Okay, so I said that this is between 0.9 and 1.2 for most materials, but here we will go all the way to 1.84. Why? Because you see, these 002 planes, They can be very far from each other as your material becomes more and more turbostratic. So the most important thing, for if you look at even a TEM pattern, you know, image, or you see an XRD pattern or anything about carbon materials, the minute you see that the separation between the D, the interlayer separation, is more than 0.335 nanometer, then you know that this is not graphite. So in the case of graphite, this is exactly 0.335 nanometer. Okay, now what happens when this distance increases? When it increases up to 3.44, it is considered turbostratic carbon. Above 3.44, although it is debated that 3.44 should be considered the limit or not, but at least traditionally, up to 3.44, it was considered turbostratic carbon. And after that, people thought that, okay, this is now, after that, it is just totally disordered, and the material was not even studied if the interlayer spacing was more than 3.44, because in that case, it is supposed to have too many curves or too many defects. But nowadays, because we understand curved carbons, we understand non-graphitizing carbons contain fullerenes and this and that. In that case, even 3.44 is not considered as a limit. We do go, even if it is, let's say, 3.5, we still call it just a turbostratic form of carbon. Okay. So the idea is that if anything is above 3.354, so if it is anything is above that, in that case it is not perfect graphite crystallite. If it is graphite, then we take the value of this shape factor K as 0.9. As it becomes more and more turbostratic, the value of K increases. In the case of completely disordered carbons, what we would assume that, okay, the value is above, the layer spacing is above 3.44. In that case, you will typically take the value of your K as 1.84 for the calculation of LA. But in the case of LC, you will still take the value between 0.9 and 1. Okay. So I have mentioned all of these here. These are the two important things. So you which planes do you use for analyzing your LA and LC? In the case of LC, LC is actually easier to calculate. LC is the stack thickness, right? Stack thickness, because we are more concerned about these 002 planes, which are also very easily visible. This is the strongest peak that you get, between 26 and 27.5, something like that. You will get this very strong peak for graphite. And that is in fact considered the signature of graphite-like carbon materials, which is your 002 peak. So this is an easy peak, easy to calculate. You will typically have reasonable shapes of this peak. This does not mean that your material is graphite, because in the case of perfect graphite, you should have perfectly Lorentzian peak, you know, very narrow peak. So if you're not getting a perfect Lorentzian peak, then it's not graphite. It's definitely not perfect graphite crystal. Still, this is the signature peak of graphitic carbons. Okay. So LC is easy to calculate, and here also your value of K is taken as 0.9. So I've already mentioned 0.9 here. In the second one, the calculation of LA, I have just written K lambda, because this is where the value of K will change. This is where it will be between 0.9 and 1.84, depending upon what is the degree of disorder in your material. So if you have completely curved carbons, completely, you know, very high disorder, in that case, you will go all the way to 1.84. Okay, and in the case of LC, as I mentioned, this is always 0.9. Okay, another important parameter is the packing density. Packing density becomes again more important when you have perfect graphite crystallized, but not in the case of non-graphitizing carbons so much. But if you want to see the packing density, and even you can calculate the number of atoms in a certain sheet of graphite, but okay, that relationship I have not mentioned here, but packing density, which is more commonly calculated, is this is the rho, and this is the formula for that, 0.762 divided by D00L. Again, 00L here, typically you will use the value 002, because that is your first order peak, and where N equals 1. But you can also potentially calculate it from 004 or 006 peaks. Okay.
Okay, so now let us solve a quick problem. Hopefully that will help you understand in case something was not clear from the slides. Okay, so you are given this particular diffractogram, and there are a few things that are given to you. For example, this is the wavelength that you have used is copper K alpha. So you already know what is the value of copper K alpha wavelength 5406, 1.5406 angstrom. Okay, so this is something that's given to you. What is this? This is your 2 theta in degree. Okay, and this is your relative intensity. Okay, so this is in arbitrary units. Okay, so this is the diffractogram that's given to you. Now, what you need to calculate is, first of all, you need to calculate the D spacing for 002 planes and also for 100 planes. Okay, that is number one. Number two, the crystallite diameter or LA. And number three, the stack thickness. Okay, so now let's get started. We have the first peak that we see. Where is approximately, what is the position of this peak? Let's draw a line here, somewhere here. Okay, so approximately, let's say I have calculated it to be 26.5. And this one here, let's say I found out that this was 43. So our first peak position is 26.5, which is for D002 planes. And the second one is at 2 theta 43, let's say. So this is for my D100 plane. So these are the values of 2 theta. And so what we need is theta values. So in this case, it will be 13.25. And here also you can accordingly find out. Okay, so this is number one. From here itself, we can calculate the D spacing. So D002 basically can be calculated by simply by Bragg's law. So N lambda, N here is 1, 2 D002 and sine of 13.25. Okay. So if you calculate this value, so the N here is 1 because it's a first order peak. If we were calculating it using 004 peak, in that case, we will take it as 2. Okay. So from here, you can already calculate. I have already calculated it. You can do this simple calculation, but it comes out to be something. What is the value? It comes out to be somewhere around 3.36. Okay, lambda here, by the way, was our 1.5406 angstrom, and that's why the value that I'll get here will also be in angstrom and not in nanometer. You can also take your lambda in nanometer. In that case, you get nanometer value. Okay, so this is your already the first part that is solved for the 002 planes, and accordingly, you can also solve it for 100 planes, whatever is the value. So this is the first part. Okay. Now, what else do we need to calculate? LA and LC. So let us first calculate the LC value. Okay, because this is the easier one. You know that in the case of LC, when we use the Scherer equation, we take the shape factor as 0.9 in the case of stack thickness. So what is your Scherer equation? K shape factor into lambda divided by beta, which is your, the width of your peak. So here we are going to take it for the 002 planes and cosine of your theta. Okay, so this is what we need to do for LC. So let's first find out what is your peak width. By the way, usually you will do it using some software. Often the XRD software will give you the peak width, and also you can take the data and find a fit in Origin or any other software for that matter. But here, let's see how do we calculate this, okay? So, well, this is my full width at half maximum. So what is the half maximum? Let's say somewhere here for my peak, okay? And now I draw two lines from here and here. And this is what I need to, this value here is what I need to see. What is it? So approximately it's 8, say 8, but that is in degree, and what I need it, I need this in radian. Okay, so let's say this value was 8 degree. So I just calculate it to radian. How do I do that? 8 multiplied by pi divided by 180. So it comes out to be something like the value I have calculated as 0.139. Okay, so that is my value in radian, and now I can just calculate the rest of it. So this is my this is basically my LC equals 0.9 into 1.5406 divided by 0.139 and whatever is the cosine of 13.25. 5. So again, I have calculated this value. It comes out to be approximately 10.25 again angstrom. So you can see that the value, it is approximately just 1 nanometer. That is your crystallite thickness. This is your stack thickness. So this is already kind of a disordered carbon. Okay, now let us now come to La value. So for La, what you need to do is here, you need to calculate the width or FWHM for the second peak. La is calculated using the 100. So you have the same formula, but what you have here is, number one, your shape factor is now 1.84. Also, because we see that the crystallites are so small and the peaks are broad, so we kind of have an idea already. It looks like a turbostratic carbon. It looks like a disordered carbon rather than a perfect graphite, because in that case you'll get relatively sharper peaks. Okay, so we take 1.84 as the value of K. So that is the major difference. Of course, the value of lambda does not change. Now here, some values, so the theta also does not, theta in this particular case will change. Theta will be your cosine of whatever is the 43/2. So that is the value that will change. And of course, the peak width, which you will calculate from your this diagram. So this value, so peak width, this also will change. And now you will, whatever it is, let's say X, and then you can calculate it for yourself. So this is how you will calculate different crystallite size and crystallite diameter from a given peak.
Okay, so now what are the different peak positions for graphite, for different planes? Okay, so the 002 plane, as I already mentioned, is between 26 and 28 2 theta. That is where you will typically observe the value. Of course, for different types of carbon materials, it can also be slightly shifted. For example, non-graphitizing carbons may have a broader peak, which will also be probably left shifted a little bit. But this is the range where you will typically observe the peak. Of course, this will also depend on the wavelength that you've used for your analysis. So most of the things that I will tell you in this lecture are, assuming that we are using copper K alpha wavelength. Okay. So this is the first one. What else? The other important peak. So in the previous slide, we also saw that in the Schreyer's equation, you will use for calculation of LC, you will use the 002. And for calculation of LA, you will use this 100 peak. Okay. So this peak is observed in most of the heat-treated carbons. So you will also have it in some porous carbons, in glass-like carbons. So as long as you have heat-treated it to a reasonably high temperature, you should be able to see this peak. However, this will be present in a broad, it becomes broader reasonably fast. Okay, but you will have this peak available for you for the calculation of La. This peak also, if the carbon materials become very, very curved and turbostratic, or the sheets are too far from each other and so on, in that case, what you are seeing is actually not a 3D structure, right? When even though I say 100 plane, it is not really 100 plane. It is 10 plane. It is not HKL. It is just HK that I'm measuring. Because this is more of a 2D structure in that case. We do not really have any 3D arrangements. So in that case, you will also find 10 plane written here and there. Instead of 100, you will say 10. This plane basically tells you more about the interatomic arrangement within a layer. So the arrangement of hexagonal rings, whether you have defects, whether you not, whether, so this is more information of one plane, and it is more of a 2D information, and that is why this is also sometimes called HK plane rather than HKL plane. However, you will see the peak at approximately 42 or 43. Okay, there are other possible peaks which are mostly present in graphite rather than other non-graphitizing carbons. Some of them are can be here and there observed, but in most cases, if you have a perfect graphite crystal, then you should be able to see all of these peaks. Okay, so 002 peaks almost always available, but definitely it broadens as the disorder increases in a material. Okay, 100 peak, as I mentioned, in most heat-treated carbons, it is present. But again, this also becomes broad reasonably fast as your disorder increases. 101 peak. this is a peak which is almost always absent if the material is not graphite. In perfect graphite only, you should be able to see this peak, 101 peak. And this 101 is approximately at 45. So 44 or 45, you will practically see it almost right after, if your spectrum is going from left to right, if your diffraction pattern is going from left to right. In that case, you should be able to almost always see it for graphite just after your peak for your 100 peak. Okay, so this 101 peak, however, is missing from all non-graphitizing carbons because even slight disorder can make this peak disappear. Okay, so maybe it will become more clear from here. So this is a typical diffraction pattern. These are the positions. These are not realistic peaks because there you will see the broadening, but these are just the positions that I have mentioned here. If you will see, I have mentioned Bragg distances rather than Bragg the 2 theta values, because this you can very easily calculate from your Bragg's law. In fact, this will be a nice little exercise for you. Okay, and the relative intensity on the on the y-axis, the intensity in most cases is mentioned in arbitrary units because this is a relative intensity. Okay, and that will depend on your crystal size, sample size, and everything. So this is always a relative value. That is why it is arbitrary units. The Bragg distances here are in nanometer. Okay, so one more important thing is that you know that as per the IUPAC, materials that have the in the X-ray diffraction studies, if you can observe a peak for graphite, which is especially the 002 peak, then you can call them graphitic. But on the other hand, that is not always true, because if it is too broad, what is the limit to which you should call it graphitic material? That's also a very interesting question. However, this is the IUPAC definition. Often we will use this the XRD studies, as I said, to understand how the graphitic content of a certain carbon increases. Okay, so now you understand that 002 peak is your most important peak that helps you calculate your LC value. Okay, you also know that in the case of perfect graphite, it is 0.335 nanometer. But as it increases, then you have turbostratic carbon. So these are some basic things that you can immediately do. Now the increase in the size of crystallites. Size of crystallites means LA values. That becomes a little more tricky to understand rather than LC value, as I had also said before. But the increase in LA and the decrease in LC is what will tell you what is the, how much graphitic your material is. So if you keep on heating your material, let's say you will have a graphitizing type carbon and you will have a non-graphitizing. Non-graphitizing carbon, even if you heat treat it at 3000 degrees, you will never see the values that you would have for perfect graphite. You will always have a peak broadening. Okay. But in the case of graphitizing carbon, first, you will have an increase in LA up to, let's say, 2000 degrees. And then what you will rather see is more organization and either decrease in LC, but if not significant decrease, at least more and more order you will see, the LC value will stay there, will not change further. Okay. But also LC value above 2200 degrees centigrade, they don't further increase. Then what we have is the graphitization process, and for that purpose, you should see the lecture on kinetics of graphitization. So you will know that this is a kinetic process and what actually takes place. Okay, so we know how to calculate LA and LC. For the most of the non-graphitizing carbon, these values are between 5 and 10 nanometer. They can also be smaller than 5 nanometer. That is then very short range order. But typical short range order in, let's say, glass-like carbons and so on, is in the order of 5 nanometer. This is what we call crystallites, although they are not really spherical crystallites, but these are regions where you have the order, and these regions are then randomly oriented in all directions, similar to a polycrystalline material. But the difference is that in the case of polycrystalline material, you have them, it's one crystal and the other, and the two crystals are not connected. But in the case of non-graphitizing carbons, all the materials, all the crystals are connected. They are not just crystals, but you also have curved structures. You have very long sheets. Maybe some part of that one particular sheet is forming a layer in another crystal. But the rest of the same sheet might be curved and might be going somewhere else and maybe participating in another crystallite. That we don't know. The point is that we have these regions. The short range order is that is of the order of 5 to 10 nanometer. This is something that you can increase by increasing the heat treatment temperature. So you will start with 2 nanometer crystallite size. You can go all the way up to 10 nanometers. For non-graphitizing carbons, not easy to go above 10. Typically, you cannot get crystallite sizes of above 10 nanometer because this is what we mean by the short range order. Okay. Here is a diagram which I have taken from this reference that I have mentioned, where you will see that for petroleum coke, if you keep on increasing the heat treatment temperature, how do the values of La and Lc change? So you can see that up to, let's say, 2000, 2100 and so on, you have pretty sharp increase in La. So what is happening is basically your crystallite diameter is increasing. That means if you had a lot of non-6-membered rings, then they are annealing out, and this network of 6-membered rings in 2D is increasing. That is the increase in La. And change in Lc, of course, it is at some point it becomes a little bit stable, because stable, you know, it does not change too much, because the value of V can only be, the minimum value is 3.35. Okay, but also the change, initially you will have the sheets too far from each other, they will come closer, but at some point they will then, it takes a lot of energy for them to convert into graphite-like sheets or ABABA type sheets, because that requires a lot of, pretty much all the defects to anneal out. So that is a very slow process. So you can see here how with the respect to the temperature, heat treatment temperature, the values of La and Lc change. Okay. Yeah, one more important thing is that most of the studies that we do they are powder diffraction studies. For carbon single crystal studies can be done on perfect graphite, natural graphite crystals. In fact, often they can you can do single crystal studies, but the intensities are pretty low. Plus, you can actually get pretty good information also from the powder diffraction. So if you have a non-graphitizing carbon, then you already have the crystallites oriented in all directions. So even if you take a solid piece of that material as a sample, still what you're going to get is a value of what you would get in powder diffraction patterns. So basically you will have the diffraction in all directions, in all possible angles, which your detector will catch anywhere. So in most cases you will do powder diffraction for carbon materials. Okay. So now this is all. I would like you to also go through some of these other NPTEL lectures. And also there were some other lectures which I had mentioned in the basic material science and engineering courses. I have mentioned in a couple of other slides and initial lectures especially. In that case, you can just go through all of these lectures. Maybe you will get much more information about crystallographic aspects and also the generation of X-rays and from different viewpoints, from physics viewpoint, from engineering viewpoint, from material science. So you can go through other NPTEL lectures. There are certain papers and books that I have mentioned here. There are various books because X-ray diffraction is a very common technique for carbon analysis. So you will find a lot of literature on this topic. There's an overwhelming amount of literature. Book and papers that I have mentioned are more specific to graphite and bulk carbons rather than carbon nanomaterials. So nanomaterials is something we have not covered, but if you understand how to measure the fundamentals of X-ray crystallography.